Just out of curiosity, how many people here have heard about Bitcoin today? How many people have used Bitcoin? Okay, we're going to change that. So today, the goal is I'm just going to explain why Bitcoin matters in simple terms. You're not going to come out here today understanding everything about Bitcoin, trust me. I've been studying this a lot since 2011. I used to actually play professional soccer until I got injured about 7 years ago. So I needed a new path, and Bitcoin came out right after then. So I immediately knew, I understood the technology, and knew that it would be something big in the future. So since 2011, I've been studying this. And I actually run a brand new Bitcoin meetup group that's been running for about 3 years now. Just this year, it started to really pick up, and I average about 10 people a meetup. But it's all different kinds of age groups, all different types of people. I've had a really enjoyable time talking to different people about this. And in terms of the business card you see there, CryptoKids is just an initiative I started several years ago where I try and educate people about Bitcoin, but I also want to try and attract youth. That's why it's called CryptoKids. Trying to attract youth that can also educate people about it, but also kind of build using this technology, as it will be a part of their future. So it would be neat to try and kind of get young kids in on this information early and start talking about it as a community group. But for sure, definitely want to get with the community as much as possible and get feedback as much as possible. So if anyone has any ideas to make this better, bigger, feel free to join, and that's what it's all about. But let's talk about why Bitcoin matters today. So it's very easy when you first hear about Bitcoin to get distracted by the features that are involved in Bitcoin. So you might get excited about the cryptography behind Bitcoin, or you might get excited about the mining behind Bitcoin, or who the mysterious creator Satoshi Nakamoto is. But all these features are great, but you miss the bigger picture of why Bitcoin matters. And that's what I'm here to show you today, is why Bitcoin matters. And I think it matters because it's the best form of money we've ever seen. It's early to notice that right now. It's sort of similar to the way the internet took off, in that it took a lot of imagination to understand how it would change the world. But the internet took off because there was a need for people to interact. I believe Bitcoin will take off because there's a need for people to interact globally without having to trust anybody else, sort of peer-to-peer interactions. And that's what Bitcoin is trying to do here. So before I get into why Bitcoin matters, the best way is to understand the history of money and the role of money first. Now with that being said, does anyone want to just try simply to explain what money is in one sentence for me? Or for everybody here? Sure.
It's an exchange of value.
Okay. Anybody else? You're sort of right. Yes.
It to give and exchange value. So you can combine both things, and that is the idea of the money behind.
Correct. So what these two gentlemen just mentioned, it was a function of money, a medium of exchange. There's three functions of money. First one is saving, store of value. Second one is spending, medium of exchange. And the third one is unit of account, the way to price things. So those are just functions of money, but what money really is.
It's controlled by the government also.
That's what I'm going to touch. It's a little myth, I believe, that I'm going to touch on here today. So the history of money. So about 100,000 years ago, the way we did trade was when tribes. So there's tribes that existed, and when tribes, you know, killed an animal, they went hunting, and whoever killed the animal had to decide who they would give this meat to. So when they traded and transacted with each other, they all walked around with this subjective ledger in their head. Subjective meant it wasn't based on facts, it was just based on opinions. So this subjective ledger is what was the way people used money, because They had to remember. There was no way to keep track of debt because that's all you were doing at that time was keeping track of who owed each other what. So it wasn't the best way to keep track of debt. You had to hope that whoever you gave the meat to would repay you back in the fairest way possible. Now this is sort of different to the way we were taught money was brought about. We kind of were taught that barter was too hard, and so money naturally came about as a way for people to transact. But I just kind of got ahead of myself and started on the subject of ledger. But yes, barter was how we were taught it happened, but it wasn't the way it progressed. So around 100,000 years ago, anthropologists found that there was no evidence of barter, and that subjective ledgers is what tribes used to keep track of debt with each other. Now, about 25,000 years ago, someone came up with this brilliant idea in a tribe and said, hey, you have some firewood. Let me get some of your firewood. You say, sure, no problem, here's some firewood. But this time, I would say, here's some beads as well. And the person would say, oh wait, I don't need any beads or I don't want any beads. And I say, it's not about the beads. It's not whether you want beads or need beads. We'll just use these beads to keep track of debt. So this was called an objective ledger. And it's objective because it's based on facts, not opinions. So what people used as an objective ledger was whatever was scarce within the environment. So different tribes chose salt, some chose rocks, some chose seashells, but it was whatever was scarce within the environment. And it also had these five attributes that they're durable, they don't decay or corrode, they're divisible, they're portable, they're recognizable, and they're fungible. So scarcity in these five attributes were great for being a ledger and keeping track of debt. It's important that it was scarce. Whatever was used as a subjective ledger is important that it was scarce, because if it wasn't scarce, anyone could just print or make fake money. Say it was tree leaves. You could just pick tree leaves for the benefit of yourself at the expense of everybody else, but just creating fake debt, picking these tree leaves. So that's why it had to be something very scarce with the environment. And so around 5,000 years ago, tribes and civilizations ended up having to trade with each other. So we all needed something in common on a global, universal scale. So about 5,000 years ago, before I even touch on that, I wanted to say that anthropologists could even predict around 25,000 years ago, or they could even predict the ledger that emerged within the environment because it was whatever was scarce within the environment. So, okay, 5,000 years ago, gold emerged as the universal ledger because it was universally scarce, and like I was saying, tribes needed to trade with each other and civilizations needed to trade with each other. So gold became the universal ledger to keep track of debt. Now, it was also very scarce, but it also had those five attributes as well: durable, divisible, fungible, portable, and recognizable.
I've never heard the word fungible.
What does that mean? Fungible, good thing you asked. It just means that if I give you one Bitcoin, you would hope that the Bitcoin you give back to me is exactly the same. What I mean by that is, like, if I give you cash, you hope that the cash you give back to me is exactly the same. It's not tainted, or it's not kind of having a different value. Like with gold, for example, you could melt out gold and add in additional metals and kind of mess with the value. So that actually used to happen with civilization as well. They would kind of create fake debt that way by messing up the gold. Okay, so before I went, that was just a very quick high-level history of money. I expressed there that a ledger is what was used as money, and it was used as a way to keep track of debt. But there are three myths about money that I even believed before I got into this. The first one is that money was born out of barter, but like we just discussed, that it was born out of just a need to keep track of debt. The second myth, and perhaps the most biggest myth, is that money is backed by something, it's backed by an asset. Right now, the universal ledger, the world's reserve currency, is the US dollar, but it's not backed by anything right now. Before, it used to be backed by gold. and people would say that, you know, the US dollar used to be backed by gold. But that implies that gold has some sort of intrinsic value beyond being a great ledger. That means maybe gold is backed by something else, but it's not. Gold is just used for power and to represent wealth. And beyond that, it's just being great at, it's just great at being a ledger because it's universally scarce. That's what gold is good for, and that's what money has been good for. It's just a, it's not backed by anything. It's just a way to keep track of debt. And then the third one is, like, I think you're in John, right? Correct? I saw you on my meetup. That's how I know your name. And the third one is that government came about because it's, or sorry, the money came about because it's government sponsored or what or whatnot. But money came about because of a social need to interact. So those are the three myths. It's not born out of barter, it's not backed by an asset, and it's not government sponsored. It's born out of a need to keep track of debt. It's also just a ledger, and the third one, it's just a social need, a way to keep track of debt. It exists because of social need. Okay. From where we stand today, it's hard to understand the importance of gold. Because right now, like I was mentioning, the universal ledger, the world reserve currency, is the US dollar. But as we're kind of talking about here, we're noticing that gold is a better ledger than paper money. I'll give you an example. From today and about 500 years ago, I mentioned gold came about 5,000 years ago, but about 500 years ago, we started seeing other universal ledgers emerge, other world reserve currencies emerge. First it was the Portuguese, then the Spanish, then the Dutch, then the French, then the British. They all had their versions of a universal ledger and world reserve currency. But if you had $100 of this money, this paper money back then, versus $100 of gold back then, so that $100 of paper money back then was worth a lot. And if you had $100 worth of gold, that would roughly be someone's yearly income back then as well. But today, if you still have that paper money, that $100, you just have $100 of paper money. But if you had that $100 of gold, you would still have a person's yearly income. So the point I'm trying to make is that gold is the best way, is the best thing we have today of keeping value. But it's not the universal ledger today. So that's something to think about. Okay, yeah. So with the importance of gold, it's been the best at keeping value. But it's kind of funny that gold, you know, today gold is the best way we have of keeping value with all the technology we have. I mean, we spend billions of dollars to dig gold out of the ground and then we lock it back underground. It's kind of very primitive with all the technology we have today. You would think maybe there's a better universal ledger that could exist. So okay, so the properties that make gold so great is, like I said before, it's scarce, but it's also durable, divisible, portable, recognizable, and fungible. Now, enter Bitcoin. Bitcoin came about in 2009. It was created in 2009. Bitcoin serves as digital money. It's a universal ledger that serves as digital money. But with gold, it's similar to gold where you don't have to trust anybody else to use it. You don't have to trust a third party. You don't have to trust a middleman. You just trust that it's scarce. And that's one of the great things about Bitcoin, is that there will only ever be 21 million Bitcoins. It's perfect mathematical scarcity. You can trust it. Whereas with gold, we mine more and more each year. And in terms of the divisibility of it, it's very easy to divide Bitcoin. You can divide them into a million things. So if any of you were interested in buying Bitcoin, you might know now when Bitcoin is worth 7,500 Canadian dollars. So So don't worry, you don't have to buy one Bitcoin, you can buy 0.1 Bitcoin, $750, or you can buy 0.01 Bitcoin, et cetera, et cetera. In terms of the portability of it, this one is also extremely important. With Gold, you voice, so if I wanted to interact with you with paper money or a gold coin, no problem. In this room today, I could just walk up to you and give you that money and we make a transaction peer to peer. But any time up until now, we wanted to make a transaction with someone outside of the room, we've always had to trust the third party. This is how banks got started a long time ago. This is how credit cards got started, and even PayPal. You can't make a transaction without finding some sort of third party or middleman. Whereas with Bitcoin, you can send any amount of money anywhere in the world extremely fast and just as cheaply. You don't have to trust the middleman, you don't have to trust the third party. Now just think about that for a second. If I wanted to call someone across the world right now, internationally, I could call them on Skype, you know? I can hear them, I can see them. But if I want to send them just a dollar, it will always cost more than just a dollar, and it'll take a long time, and you always have to trust the third party. Now it's kind of odd that with all the technology we have with Skype, you can hear them, you can see them, but if you wanted to send $1, you can't do that. So this is what Bitcoin aims to solve. And it is already doing that.
Is that a fee for this transaction?
Sorry?
Is that a fee for this transaction?
There is a fee. At the end, I'm going to get into detail about what Bitcoin is. Right now, I'm just kind of talking about why it matters, but I will answer that near the end when I talk about what Bitcoin is, because just right now, I can say Bitcoin is a network and a currency. It's a computer network, kind of like the internet, but it's also a currency. A currency is the application on this network. So to use this network, yes, there's a little bit of a fee, but I'll show you how it's all just peer-to-peer. So,
I have one more question. So, how many Bitcoins are currently available? You said 21 million at the cap.
Yes.
So, how many are available and when is that high cap to reach?
Okay, now I have to answer that one at the end. I have to get on tech, but I'll answer the story. Okay, so. Okay, so. We're just finishing off the history of money and why Bitcoin matters. So this is the first time in 5,000 years we've found something in terms of scarcity, in terms of those five qualities. This is the first time in 5,000 years that we found something immensely superior in all aspects to gold. So I just touched about the scarcity of it, the divisibility of it, the portability of it. In all aspects, it's immensely better. So there's the three functions of money. Is a store of value, medium of exchange, and unit of account. The way I see Bitcoin taking off is first starting as a store of value, a way of saving. So right now you'll see the majority of people that have Bitcoins, they're holding them and saving them because they believe in them. Naturally, I think once more people start to accept it, more businesses accept it, you'll see it become a medium of exchange. And then lastly, a unit of account. But I believe that Bitcoin is on the way to becoming the universal ledger that will replace the gold standard and the US dollar, and will naturally become the native currency on the internet that, like I said, will be the universal ledger and also the world reserve currency. That it won't replace other government currencies or national currencies, but it'll just become the universal ledger in which these government currencies will have to base their value off of. That was why Bitcoin matters. Before we get into what Bitcoin is, does anybody have any questions so far? Did I say anything unclear? Did anything not make any sense? Yes?
Why is that there's only 25 million of the Bitcoin?
Okay, so the reason why there's only 21 million Bitcoins is to make a scarce digital asset. Because there's two problems with money that existed before Bitcoin. One was called the double spending problem, and two was called the Byzantine generals problem. The double spending problem with, like I said, with gold, you can melt it out and add in other metals. And with paper money, you can for sure easily double spend and print more than actually exists. So the reason why Bitcoin has 21 million is to create a scarce digital asset. And over time, that will become more valuable. But also this 21 million, if you divide it into a million bits, it's supposed to equal the amount of debt that exists on the global economy today. Does that sort of make sense? But, and I mentioned the other problem with money that Bitcoin solved, is the Byzantine General's problem. It's a problem in computer science where there was no, like I mentioned before, there's no way for a group of people or persons to interact with each other outside of the group. We always had to trust a third party. So what Bitcoin created was this network. It's called the, like I was saying, it's a network and a currency. So this network is also a consensus network, which means that whoever uses the network agrees on the state of this network. So I say network, but I also was touching on before is that it acts as a ledger. So you can also think of Bitcoin as just one big public ledger, the network that it runs on, but Bitcoin is just a currency that's used on this ledger. So you can also think of the network as just a big public ledger and a way to keep track of everybody's debt. And you can go online and you can verify that everything's true and everyone has this amount of money because it's all based on cryptography and all that stuff. She had her hand up first there.
So the 21 million will never change?
Never.
So it's not like the Federal Reserve where they decide to print more money to control inflation?
That's the number one thing that I love about Bitcoin, is that you can't change it. This network, people use this term now, that it's an immutable ledger. That's the biggest value proposition that Bitcoin has, is that you cannot change it. So the way...
But you say it's not going to change, yet there's forks. So it will split. And
yes.
Right.
Which so is then another already. Currency will exist, but the Bitcoin currency will remain the same.
Well, you got Bitcoin, now you got Bitcoin Cash and Ether. And
yes.
So there's multiple avenues that are happening.
Yeah, so what happens there is, so what Bitcoin is, it's a protocol. Like everybody knows software. Someone created software freely, and on this cryptographer mailing list, they released it freely and said, here's a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. And it only gained value because people used it and people built on it. This protocol, it's voluntary, it's decentralized, and it's open source. So you don't have to ask anybody permission to join it, and decentralized means nobody owns it, nobody controls it, nobody runs it. But the third one, open source, is you can build on it and make it better. So since it came out in 2009, there's been people all over the world constantly building on this Bitcoin network and making it better. I'll touch on how you would secure this network and what makes it unchangeable, but first I just want to explain what John brought up, is that now what you're seeing, because Bitcoin has been performing so well, like I mentioned, one Bitcoin was worth $7,500, $7,500 Canadian, which is worth more than any other currency or asset that exists today. So this is not just for no reason. And if you've seen the way it happened, it was very volatile in the beginning. The network wasn't secure in the beginning, but it only got more secure and less volatile over time. But what you're starting to see happen is you're starting to see these other fork coins or altcoins, alternative currencies. These are all just called cryptocurrencies because they're based on cryptography. But you're seeing these pop up because they're trying to steal Bitcoin's shine. So you can literally copy the Bitcoin code because it's open source, and you can create your own. What happened is you see Bitcoin Cash. And so these developers that created Bitcoin Cash, they said, hey, anyone who has Bitcoin, we'll give you the equal amount of Bitcoin Cash when it starts. And then you can decide what to do with there. This is all great and all, but it hasn't performed nearly close to the way Bitcoin has, and it doesn't. These fork coins and these altcoins that you're seeing come about, in terms of use cases and value propositions, it's all speculative. And they all have to base their value off of Bitcoin's value. So you may agree with Ethereum and whatever, but if you talk about what their value proposition is and what their use cases are, it's all speculative, and it's all used to sort of make money. Like if everyone here has heard of ICOs today, these are initial coin offerings where people just, so like, I have this CryptoKitties. I'm trying to get it out organically just through word of mouth. But you're seeing companies go, oh, hey, I have an idea. Let's create an ICO with this idea. So people just create a token based off of this idea, but the investors that are investing in it, they're investing in the token. They're not investing in the idea. If you look at the ICOs that exist today, 99% of them are speculative. There's probably like a couple, a handful that have actual real use cases with this token. So we got a little bit off track there, but I think everyone, are we kind of all on the same page? We're starting to understand a little bit.
Why it has to be the ceiling is 21 units?
Is it just an arbitrary number?
Yes, it is just an arbitrary number that this person or a group, we don't know who created it. They did it anonymously. They just freely gave this software.
What was the significance?
Sorry?
What's the significance of 21?
Oh, like he said, it's just an arbitrary number. He just chose the number, or not he, like we don't know who it is. This person or group just chose this number to create a scarce digital asset. So I did say there's only 21 million Bitcoins, but it's not like they're all just out there right now, these 21 million Bitcoins. These 21 million Bitcoins, they started getting distributed into the ecosystem slowly. So in 2009, Bitcoins got distributed through a process called mining. Who here has heard of mining? Okay, does anyone want to take a stab at what mining is?
Solving algorithms.
Sorry. You said solving algorithms, right? Solving, correct. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, it's a way to validate transactions and based on solving those algorithms. So that could happen in Bitcoins, Ethereum, so whatever ICO you have.
Correct. So
is this what you want obsolete that does not fluctuate up and down well? So it is like an abstract number, let's say?
Yes. So the way Bitcoins got distributed was in 2009. It happened like this. You would get 50 Bitcoins as a reward for verifying transactions and solving these algorithms. On the Bitcoin network, it's called proof of work. On other networks, there's proof of stake, which isn't as secure as proof of work. Because for proof of work, you have to give your computer power. You have to use your computer power to try and solve these problems. Now, anyone who used the network back in 2009, now mind you, back in 2009, 2010, if I had went on my laptop and just typed in YouTube, how to mine Bitcoins and how to start mining Bitcoin, I probably wouldn't be here today because you could get a lot of Bitcoins just using your computer power. But today, the computer power that you have to compete against are huge computer farms in different parts of the world. And there's, for one person to try and mine Bitcoins is not profitable anymore at all. But what this makes you think is that, okay, this network must be really secure then, because this is what happened. 2009, you would get 50 Bitcoins as a reward. So this reward is put out on the network, on the Bitcoin network, every time transactions happen. So who here has heard of the term blockchain? Okay, so blockchain and Bitcoin go hand in hand. I'm talking about network and currency. Blockchain is that network. I'm talking about consensus network. Blockchain is that consensus network. I talked about universal ledger. Blockchain is the network behind that universal ledger. But all the blockchain is when transactions happen on the Bitcoin network, they get grouped into a block. And every 10 minutes, you have a chance to mine this block and get a reward for mining this block. So the first set of blocks, or the first block that happened, had a reward of 50 Bitcoins, and it put all the transactions that happened on the network into this block. So by using your computer power to, it's called hashing. There is a difference between hashing and mining that I'm going to touch on in a little bit. But you're using your computer power, so you're hashing, to try and solve these algorithms. It's called proof of work problems, so you prove the work. And you try and solve these proof of work problems to try and get a reward. You're not always going to get a reward, but the more computer power you have, the greater chance you have of getting a reward. So that's why you start to see the progression of more computing power and different parts of the world computing, mining farms or hashing farms starting to pop up and try and solve these problems. So it started off at 50, but the neat thing about Bitcoin and this 21 million is it's halved every 4 years until there is no more Bitcoin to be distributed, which is estimated around 2050. So starting 2009 with 50 Bitcoins as a reward, 4 years later, it was 25, another 4 years, 12 and a half, and right now we're at 7.25, I believe, for getting a reward for mining Bitcoin. So to answer your question, over half of the Bitcoins have already been mined and have already been distributed. And I've even heard of a stat where about 25% of the Bitcoins have been lost by people trying to use it and send it to each other, because so early on, there weren't many services that you could use Bitcoin safely and securely, but now there's, you have so many to choose from, and I feel so safe. I wouldn't want to use any other type of money. This is how safe and easy it is to use. Yes?
When you're saying lost, so does that mean you can actually lose a Bitcoin in cyberspace?
Yes. But like I was trying to, I didn't want to scare anybody, I was just trying to kind of really remind you that very early on these things happened, because the way you held Bitcoins at the beginning was, you know, on your computer. There wasn't, you couldn't go on your phone and go on the Google Play Store and type in Bitcoin wallet and download a Bitcoin wallet. Now there's tons of different Bitcoin wallets to use. If you see on my card there, I actually got hired for Bitcoin wallet recently where I do customer support and get paid in Bitcoin, which is extremely rare. But so I'm biased and I'm gonna say use this wallet, but I've always recommended this wallet before I got hired by them. So it's called Samurai Wallet, but there's Green Address, Electrum. Any of you want that information, just email me, I can help you out. But yes, at the beginning it was harder to use Bitcoin. There wasn't a way to back up your Bitcoin wallet, but now there's tons of ways. So if you create a Bitcoin wallet today, the first thing it asks you to do is write down this 12-word seed before you create a password, obviously. So you are going to have to get used to creating strong passwords and using technology, but as the years progress, I think services will make it easier for people to use. But so you create your strong password, but also you write down a 12-word seed that this wallet gives you. This seed is to back up. You can also create a backup as well on your computer, on your external device. But if you just wanted to memorize this 12-word seed or write it down and store it in different places, you can do that, because if that phone gets lost or stolen, you just go to another desktop or phone, go on the Play Store, download the same wallet, and all you have to do is input those 12 words and all your money will be restored automatically.
What if the mobile phone gets hacked?
So I recommend people use wallets that allow two-factor authentication as well. Two-factor authentication I'm a huge fan of. I use two-factor authentication on everything. My email, my wallets, everything. Because you are starting to see that more. You're starting to see hackers try and take advantage of people that aren't using secure services. So two-factor authentication, there's lots of different services. There's Google Authenticator, there's Authy, A-U-T-H-Y, and also Duo Mobile. Those are all two-factor authentication services, but most wallets you'll see have set up with Google Authenticator, and it's great because I have it on my other phone, so if anyone stole my phone and wanted to send Bitcoin, they would need my other phone to make the transaction happen. But I also have, since Samurai Wallet is so neat, there's also a feature you can use that if you do lose your wallet or phone, you can sort of, it's not like self-destruct, but it'll make your wallet, the funds in your wallet, move from that wallet to another Bitcoin wallet that you have access to. So there's different features, there's different services that you can use that make it very easy and safe to use Bitcoin now. But at the beginning, it wasn't very safe. There's a chance you can use it. Yes.
So is it retrievable? So
yes.
In the early stages, they didn't have that many wallets, but they have certain wallets. Like say your blockchain, the code is like at least 20 letters.
Yeah.
That's your identification code.
Yeah.
So even memorizing, it's hard, and then a code, because I had trouble. I can't get in mine.
Are you, I think the 20...
I signed up to it with, like, when it first came out, Bitcoin. And Bitcoin was really cheap.
Yeah, and so you use a blockchain wallet. Yeah. Same thing with me, like, back around 2011, 2013 even, blockchain wallet was the most prolific wallet at the time, but I would never use that today because of how poor it is in terms of...
Yeah, like, I can't get back into it. I probably, like, that Bitcoin, I bought it when it first came out. So that Bitcoin is equivalent, that Bitcoin's worth more than the Bitcoin is worth now. I spent a lot less.
Yeah.
So it's probably worth at least 10 Bitcoin, if I could ever get in it.
Now...
If. And that's a big if, because I just signed up to it by accident, because my brother kept telling me about this, and he made it for me, and I bought it, and that's it. I don't know how to do it. That's why I'm trying to hop with the hell. How do you retrieve it?
I think See, this is what I was trying to explain to her, that early on, if you didn't download the right wallet or didn't have a backup of any sort, because I do remember blockchain wallet, they did give you a way to back up the wallet, but if you didn't do that and you sort of made transactions, and I'm going to have to talk to you personally because I have heard of situations where people have tried using a wallet and maybe sent it to a wrong address, and it kind of got lost in cyberspace that way, which has happened, and you can get it back.
Yeah, I Googled it, and they said there are multiple cases of multiple people losing different cryptocurrency or whatever that. That's why there's that high percentage of Bitcoin that's, they don't know where it's gone.
Yes, so.
And I'm one of those, unfortunately.
But honestly, like your case isn't as bad. I've heard of someone who had like a hard drive worth, I mean, this was several years ago too, worth like $50 million worth of Bitcoin, and now you can only imagine how much more that is.
$50 million, holy, like, that's a lot.
Yeah, so don't think about, because like me, you know, I was telling you guys, I got involved in 2009. What if I had typed in how to mine Bitcoin in 2009? But I did. If I did, I would have made a lot of money, and maybe I wouldn't be standing here right now. But everything happens for a reason. And to be honest, I would much rather be here rather than have lost some money. It's hard to understand, but I
trust you.
You know what I mean? If I made a lot of money in 2009, I wouldn't want to talk to people about Bitcoin and try to educate people about Bitcoin. I'd be wanting to do what I did, like, you know, start a company or something like that. But I really had to think, like, okay, how can I best use what I know now? So I'm just,
So for people that want safety, would you say that hardware wallets are the best?
No. There's different ways to hold Bitcoins. There's hardware, I thought you meant hot wallet. Hardware wallet, for sure, is a great way to hold Bitcoins and keep your Bitcoin safe, because this is an example of a cold wallet. So a hot wallet is a wallet you would download on your phone or on your desktop. And it's called a hot wallet because it's online. That's all the only reason why it's called hot. Cold wallet is the best because it's offline. So there's different hardware devices that you can buy where you can send your Bitcoins to this hardware device and keep them offline. And that's the best way for a lot of people to secure their Bitcoins, because they know it can never get tampered with this way. But also on top of that, you can have two-factor authentication, you can memorize a 12-word seed, back up a seed as well. So there's lots of different ways to back up.
Great question. So you're talking about the fork, right? Bitcoin fork. Mm-hmm. You said whenever there is a fork, people who hold Bitcoins will get equal support from Bitcoin. So they get, you say equal number of Bitcoins. Like, is it one Bitcoin equals one Bitcoin cash? Because one Bitcoin is like 7,900 Canadian dollars.